knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we discussed the nature of Australopithecus as a genus, which broadly lived from 4.2 to 1.9 million years ago. By this genus, all hominins are bipedal, and thus they have the morphologic suite of characteristics that define such a locomotor style. Recall that this suite of characteristics includes the anterior foramen magnum, the valgus knee, the bowl-shaped pelvis with anteriorly oriented iliac blades, 3 foot arches, and an inline hallux. There are many other traits, such as muscle attachment sites, but this group necessitates bipedalism in the organisms it is found in. This is important, as the hominins we will discuss here display this suite in the material we have of them. First, we will discuss a rare and poorly known hominin, Kenyanthropus platyops. Kenyanthropus lived 3.2 to 3.3 million years ago and is known from a site called Lomequi. This site should be familiar, as we discussed the tools found there in the context of the previous hominin, Australopithecus. As we mentioned, basic tools have been found at the site and dated to around 3.3 million years ago. The makers of these tools may be Kenyanthropus, although Australopithecus is also reported at the site. Kenyanthropus differs from Australopithecus most clearly in its much flatter face and smaller teeth. Some paleoanthropologists have thus linked this hominin to Homo rudolfensis, or as the potential ancestor of genus Homo. Still, the best remains of this hominin are the KNMWT-40,000 skull, which is badly crushed and distorted, leaving certainty of its anatomy and phylogeny up for debate. Around 3 million years ago, a large split occurred in genus Australopithecus. It is generally thought that this genus is ancestral to our own genus, Homo, but it is also thought to be ancestral to another genus, Paranthropus. Paranthropus is thus considered to be a sister group to our genus Homo, a group of strange cousins. Paranthropus emerged as East Africa was transitioning from woodland to savanna, and this makes sense as Paranthropus is broadly thought to be a grass-eating ape. Australopithecus, as well as genus Homo, were much more general in what they consumed, which is why Paranthropus is something of a specialist. Its preference for grasses is reflected in both its morphology and its stable isotopes. There are currently 3 species in this genus. The oldest is Paranthropus aethiopicus at 2.7 million years ago, which is known from East Africa and represented most beautifully in the black skull specimen. Similarly, Paranthropus boisei is from 2.5 million years ago and is potentially a direct descendant from the former hominin. Paranthropus robustus is younger at 2.27 million years and is found in South Africa rather than in the East. Like what we saw with Australopithecus, it may be that hominins migrated down the east side of the continent when it was forested, only to become stuck in the south when the forests disappeared. Paranthropus of all species are known from a few characteristic traits. They all have a structure known as a sagittal crest, a large pinch of bone that runs along the top of the skull. This feature anchors the temporalis muscle, which tells us Paranthropus had an incredible ability to chew. It has zygomatics, or cheekbones, that are pushed anteriorly, and like the sagittal crest, this allowed for powerful chewing muscles in the form of the masseter. Paranthropus had enormous molars as well, with some representations being 4 times the size of human molars. Finally, the stable isotopes found in this hominin are heavily skewed towards C4 plants, supporting the notion that it was a grass eater. Paranthropus was kind of like a cow ape given its diet, but it looks a lot like Australopithecus in the rest of its anatomy. It was bipedal with a larger brain than a chimpanzee at around 500 to 550 cubic centimeters. Paranthropus is often found alongside other hominins, usually early members of genus Homo. This means the species were both contemporaneous and sympatric. They lived at the same time and in the same place. We see this in many modern ecosystems. Orangutans live alongside gibbons, and gorillas sometimes live alongside chimpanzees. This is possible because the genera occupy different niches and do not necessarily have to compete. However, the interactions between Paranthropus and early Homo may not be as cut and dry. Recent work out of Nyanyanga in Kenya has revealed the presence of Oldowan tools, Paranthropus remains, and butchered hippo remains together with no genus Homo. There are a few potential explanations for this. It could be that Paranthropus made the tools and butchered the hippos, perhaps opportunistically. This would not be surprising, given that Paranthropus had the morphological suite to make tools, a big enough brain and dexterous hands. Not to mention, herbivorous primates today will opportunistically eat vertebrates. It could also be that the tools were made by genus Homo species living alongside Paranthropus in the area, and they simply didn't preserve. We have seen the two living together at other sites, so this is not outside the realm of possibility. Lastly, it could be that both genera lived at the site, and that Homo butchered both Paranthropus and the hippos. Primates eating other primates does happen, after all. Further work must be done to know for certain whether Paranthropus was a toolmaker, but given that its ancestors and sister species could make tools, it does not seem like a stretch. Paranthropus as a genus would survive for millions of years, living until as recently as 800,000 years ago, when our direct ancestors would have roamed the land. The reason Paranthropus went extinct is unknown, but while it would yield no descendants to the modern day, another hominin genus would. Genus Homo. Let's move forward and begin to discuss this genus next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.